Please, nobody get hurt here tonight. So, thought we'd work from the, we'll start with we're gonna do two variations. We're gonna do one where we're escaping side control, and then we're gonna do another one where we're inside, working from the half guard. And this is like a principle that you can apply to different positions. And to me, this is one of the more high percentage submissions you can catch. Even if you don't want to catch the submission, it's going to help your escape and your guard retention considerably. Because something that happens a lot when someone's pinning you, as long as he's controlling my hips, he can use his arms in any manner he wishes, freely. There's nothing I can do to these grips. But the minute I create a buffer, any sort of frame where I can put space and distance between our hips, his grips now become a liability. And usually what happens here is I start to implement my escape. I create enough space with my hip and I put my knee in here. And what'll happen here is as soon as I do this, a lot of people will frame and start moving away. But you see, it's kind of like a reset. Look, Professor Mark. I have no control over his upper body. And usually it's the same thing. They stuff the knee and repass, and then you're back to square one. Something you always want to be mindful of is when you start to create that frame, when your knee comes in, you want to control the arms. Generally speaking, you'll want to control both arms, but the crossface arm is sufficient enough a lot of times. What'll happen here is I have good control on the hip, forearm here. I'm going to create a little bit of space. You see how my hand is framed this way, which is the better of the two arm frames. I don't have my arm out. It's on his shoulder. This is gonna really come into play in a minute. I escape my hip, put my knee inside. Now, as soon as my knee comes in, elbow to your, ear to shoulder, I bite down on his arm, start to circle my elbow up, and you see how my shin is framing off his hip. This arm is blocking. You don't wanna make the mistake of going like this, because there's no way I can stop him from bringing his weight forward. Even though I have the shin, see, that'll collapse on me. So this frame will help bite, rotate, and it's like a corkscrew. I see how I rotate my hips to the outside. My ear is against my shoulder, which is his wrist is in the middle. In the beginning, be okay with, I'm totally cool with how you guys want to control the elbow, but what we're doing is we're corkscrewing his arm. I want to get his elbow capsule pointed to the ceiling. That gives me the leverage right here to start to pinch and pull down, and that's the arm bar. If you want to add more pressure, that leg now comes over, and I just apply downward pressure on his shoulder. But this is a super high percentage way of attacking the arm while you're escaping. How I get the control, my foot can come out, but I keep the shin here. One thing that'll happen a lot is you develop this, you may not have the exact sweet spot to get the finish, but the more you corkscrew and rotate, the more pressure you put on the shoulder, your partner has to roll. And it puts you right into the mount with good elbow control. You can segue into your Americanas, your S-mount arm bars. He needs to get that back before he can think of anything else. So, at the very least, in the beginning, you slow down his ability to repass because I have this arm, even if I don't have the arm bar. And if he rips his arm away, I've escaped effectively. There's no way he's gonna repass. So you're gonna start here. You see both arms are framed properly. Knee comes out or hip comes out. When the knee goes in, this frame stays. My hand comes up, I work the knee through and keep rotating your hip. Now I can use both hands for the arm lock. I can keep rotating, or worst case, back to guard. Last thing I want to just point out, because this is very important. When you do techniques like this on a newer student, you have to take care. And especially for newer students that are in Professor Mark's position, when I get control like this, Even though I may not be applying breaking pressure just yet, I have pretty good control on his arm. If he tries, then don't do it. But if he tries to yank his arm out, he's gonna pop his own elbow. So everything in this space, just be careful. You create so much leverage and pressure while you're rotating. Take care, the top person. If they try to pull their arm out, it's just gonna get worse. So this is why whenever you're escaping side control, the top person, as soon as that knee comes in, they have to extract their arms. That's how you reset. You're just going to deny them that. Come out and block right here. Now I rotate the hip. Once my hip comes out, now the frame can come out and I can lock on his arm. Okay, we're gonna start from this position first, from cross side. Are there any questions?
Yeah.
Yes.
I noticed you don't really do any of the hold the telephone with your head and shoulder on them.
When you first catch it, yes. When you first catch it, because of the angle. Here, I will do this, but as I rotate my hip, not so much.
Okay.
And that's why I said, you can keep the rotation and sweep the guy, but if I really want to finish him, then it's this one here, and I prefer to even get my foot on his hip. Now you have all the leverage you need, and it's just the squeeze, but I'm not too fixated on, because I have it right here.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Anybody else? Awesome, let's go. One, two, three. Now we're gonna work half guard, same scenario. Again, this position without a frame is very dangerous. Like, I don't have the means to stop. Just simply driving the cross face into my neck, it's hard to stop because I have no way of controlling the distance between our hips. So a lot of times you're gonna get this type of control from the person on top. Heavy cross face, deep underhook. So we've gone over in here many times how to create a wedge. All we're doing here, the first thing I wanna do is, if he's in tight, I wanna open my head and shoulders out first, because we're gonna escape from the inside. So I need to create a little bit of space. You have your inside frame blocking. You never wanna put your hand on their hip, because if they switch their base, you can hurt your wrist. But the knee's not bad. And all I'm doing is I move my head and shoulders out. That creates a little bit of a gap. Now my hip comes out and the knee pops through. And as soon as the knee pops through, we're back to the same thing. The only difference here is, because you see this leg, I can work the same material for the submission. I can put my foot on his hip now, bring this knee up, and start the angle to attack the arm. But the nice thing about this, you put enough pressure, one of two things, anytime that elbow gets in danger, you're gonna feel a little bit of forward pressure coming from your opponent. I'm just gonna work the hook sweep. But the key here is I wanna bring his weight towards me a little bit, so I lift like this, not out, but up, because I wanna bring his hips forward, his weight forward, but I wanna make him light on this leg. And as soon as I bring my hook up, it's like a scissor sweep. I just chop, we go to the mount, and again, we still have really good elbow control to follow up. The head and shoulders move out first to create sufficient space on the inside to create a frame. Now the hips move out so the knee can come through. It's a very high percentage way to get your knee back from this position. But once this happens, I make sure that hand doesn't come out, a frame. We move the hip to the outside. I can still work on the arm, or I start to engage the hook sweep. I bring my knee up, then this leg chops. And because the hips are so close, settle in the mount, feet under the hips, knees out, and keep this elbow up high. Then you have offensive options right from there.
Can I ask a question, Jim?
Of course, sir.
So as you're doing that, do they ever try and knee slice over your bottom leg?
When you're going, are you talking about if I move my head and shoulders out?
No, not yet. Like, once you further into the move, he's gonna knee slice over your left leg. No, the other one.
So keep going this way?
Yeah, that way. But later, once he moves his hips to the other side.
Once I get here like this, because I have a hook.
Push that?
See, I have the hook.
You don't ever push your left leg down and get his knee over it?
He can push my, if he does that, go ahead, sir. Because I have the hook.
Okay.
Definitely have the hook, yeah. That's when it becomes dangerous for him. The only, this is why without a frame, he can lift his hip up. He can go knee cut to the inside with his knee. He can go three-quarter mount to the outside. It's very challenging. So that's why I want to get this in. Mm-hmm. Now I have a wedge. Any elevation he makes with his hip to do anything, the hook is there. And because I have the hook and this arm, it just makes his options more limited. If I'm not controlling the arm, he can start to really elevate his hip and create different angles to even break down a single butterfly hook. But controlling the arm neutralizes a lot of that.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Anybody else? Do we need to see it again? We good? Awesome. Let's go. 1, 2, 3.